Welcome to this week's episode of Take 5 Friday, where we talk the people and process behind making and maintaining the U.S. diplomatic presence around the world. This week, we are highlighting our embassy effect with a special edition episode featuring Chuck Bond, president of B.L. Harbert's International Group. B.L. Harbert's work for OBO around the world not only impacts our portfolio, but also has a positive effect on the people and places in the communities within which they do work. We call this the embassy effect. These effects touch in economic, environmental, and social ways and have an ongoing positive impact on local communities. Embassy Effect is collecting and showcasing the influence of U.S. diplomatic portfolio work in the cities within which we operate around the world. We are thrilled to have Chuck speak on Embassy Effect and how OBO projects have helped shape B.L. Harbert's corporate culture, and look forward to having him join us again for a future episode about his career and work with OBO. Welcome. So let's see.
All right.
3, 2, 1.
All right. Hey, welcome everybody, and welcome Christina Hudson. I am super excited to get a chance to really introduce you to our OBO family. I know you and I have worked now for a couple of years in support of climate security and resilience, getting that program up and on its feet. But I'm really hopeful now we'll get a chance for everybody else to see what a gem we have in Christina. So why don't we start really with just a little bit about yourself, Christina. What do you do now and how did you get there?
Sure. Hello. I'm happy to be here. So I currently live in Washington, D.C., but I grew up living overseas in what we used to call developing countries. And they are countries that might not be as wealthy as the United States, but they are there. And my father was providing public health support. So I think by living in Africa and Asia and South America as a young child, it has given me a different perspective on how fortunate we are that 9 times out of 10, you turn on the faucet in the kitchen and that water is good to go. And that you could go outside, and most, for the most part, aside from perhaps wildfires and other pollutants, you can breathe the air and know that you're going to be fairly safe. So I take all that into consideration into how I got to where I am now, because I currently support a military department on their climate adaptation and resiliency efforts. And that's been going on for about 4 years. And one would think that that was not a priority in the last 4 years, but Congress and others were still interested in what the Department of Defense was doing. So it may have been a bit underground, but it still existed. One of the benefits that I've had in terms of getting where I am right now is that I supported NASA headquarters starting in 1999. And for those of you that were born, that's when we were talking about things like pollution prevention. And we shifted from pollution prevention to encroachment, to sustainability, and now to climate risks. So I think it's important to recognize that there's a linkage between those items and that they nest within each other, and none of them are superfluous, and they're all important and can inform what we're going to be doing moving forward.
That's perfect. Yeah, I think we all relate when it comes to having been in places overseas to see it's just not the same as it is in the United States. So in our response can't be the same to the hazards that we're facing over there. And definitely the relevance of the maturity of this discipline of adaptation and resilience, right? It just didn't happen overnight. It's matured quite a bit, that you've helped it along the way, and we're just getting started really as an organization to do it intentionally. So, I mean, it's perfect for you to kind of now share a little bit more about that career, the people, the projects, the programs that you worked on that have kind of inspired you, led you to our doorstep to where you can help us advance our program.
Yeah, thanks. There have been a lot of special people along the way, and I treasure those that were the ones that they seek learning from you and also push learning on from them to you. And I'll name Sam Higuchi and NASA headquarters, since retired, as one in particular, because he has had that impression and that influence on many, many people in this space. He's probably the first one to sort of push us to think about this in a bigger sense than we had been before when I was supporting NASA. So I think people like him and others who want to do the cutting edge. So I was lucky enough to be supporting OSD when they wrote their first climate change roadmap back in 2012. I was fortunate enough to work with NAFAC when they developed their planning handbook for climate considerations. And that was a wonderful way of trying to put on paper some of the things that we knew conceptually and academically might work. But how do you establish a framework that could be flexible enough to address any of the types of hazards that might be present and be used by other organizations, such as yourselves, in your work? So it has been a joy to see things transition. And the small group of individuals who may have been talking about this in the mid-2000s has just grown. And it's wonderful to see organizations for which that is their goal and purpose, is to increase the ability of people to serve in the climate adaptation space. So it's been a lot of fun.
I mean, that's definitely something that we've noticed, that we're not the only ones doing this, and nor are we the first to start. So, you know, you and other people like you in our that we've met along the way have certainly helped us to frame how we're approaching it. And we're pleased to have, you know, in part the author of the roadmap that we're gonna use once we identify where we're most exposed. How do we really achieve this thing called resilience? And that kind of leads me to my next question. The idea in our organization, we know what engineers are, architects are, you know, we get it. We do infrastructure, we design and construct and maintain. And those are the people that generally do it. But in walks an adaptation practitioner to a meeting, right? Well, what is that? An adaptation practitioner. Why is that role important to us now as well?
Well, I've been called a lot of things, but that's actually a nice thing to be called. So I appreciate that. So it's interesting. If you take the word adaptation, I consider what I do to be, I need to be adaptable to the circumstance and to the audience for which I'm speaking or interfacing with. So you have a lot of very smart people, architects, engineers, specialists in you know, transportation or utilities or whatever. They know what they do best. They understand the processes that are in place. They understand the policies, the rules, the benchmarks, the standards. And so I see it as an opportunity to lay on one more factor, the consideration of future climate and how it might impact what they want to do and the decision that they're trying to make, so that they can lay it in where it is appropriate, and I can guide them as to where it's appropriate, when it's appropriate. And in some cases, honestly, it might turn into a conversation where we've gone through that and there is no place that's appropriate or necessary. So I think a lot of people think that, oh my gosh, here comes Christina, and now we're going to have to stop everything and start over. And it's really not that. It's acknowledging you've had this conversation, and for whatever reason, for mission purposes, I have to be in this place 24/7. And this is just one other thing I'm going to have to address by building stronger, understanding what my redundancies are, where I can move away to get out of the line of a bad storm event, and so forth. So I see it as someone who listens a lot and helps others understand. And often I don't even use the word climate change. It's just like, don't you want to be here for the long term? Don't you want to think strategically? We all like to think strategically, but we're often forced to be tactical. So how can you take into consideration future risks now so that over time you can build in resiliency? Often, if you do analyses, very rarely is it the sky is falling right away. So you have time. So how can you think about how you can best use that time in terms of planning, in terms of budgeting, in terms of programming and designing? So that's the really fun part of it, because you see these aha moments with individuals and groups, and you're like, okay, great.
Right. I think we definitely, it's forcing us to be a lot more predictive, to look beyond into those future epics and to look at scenarios versus, you know, just purely weighing risk. So I can't be credited with that adaptation practitioner, Ann Cosmall, coined it. I stole it from her.
Yeah, she's another large inspiration, larger than life, brilliant woman.
So that Federal Adaptation Resilience Group that she invited us to, and I know you're a part of, you know, really does kind of illustrate there are a lot of people working in this space and doing great things, and that they're excited now about the new executive order, which really, you know, for us is also an exciting opportunity because it specifically mentions abroad, tackling the climate crisis at home and abroad. Wait, does that mean us? Does that mean finally the embassies are going to have to be responsive to this executive order? And that is true. We are close to rolling out the State Department's Climate Adaptation and Resilience Plan. Many of us worked on it for months following that announcement back in January. So we're very eager to get started. There's a lot of things on our to-do list. So what's your message out there, just, you know, for the general OBO family about what listeners can do to support that idea of resilience now? How do we build that into our psyche, our day-to-day work?
That's a great question. And I think that my stance has always been that this is not a one-person job. So I have found that some of the best ideas have come from those who are in the midst of it. And they might not have the grand title. They might not be the ambassador, or even the ambassador, however, could have a good idea. But they're the ones that know O&M best or design and construction best. And often they, if given the liberty to think creatively, they often have very good suggestions. And I would argue that everyone has the ability and the responsibility, the fiduciary responsibility, to put forth ideas that can create a better, more resilient, and, you know, beautiful infrastructure. I've seen some of the State Department embassies of late, and the designs or even the ones that are construction are just astounding in terms of their reflection of the country's landscape and culture, and yet providing a safe harbor for those who work there and those who visit there, in order that OBO can, the U.S. Department of State can do its job.
Perfect. Yeah, we welcome you with open arms, really, into the state family, you know, and hope that you look forward to the excitement that we share in deploying this mission, you know. Putting that flag up over an embassy and seeing it there after one of these events is going to be a beautiful thing.
Yes.
So thank you so much for helping us, Christina, to achieve that goal.
You're very welcome.
Thanks for tuning in to Take 5 Friday. We hope you'll join us again next week for a conversation with Bruce Faudry, Vice President and Director of International Programs at Mason & Hinger. See you then.